Section 1 of Constructive Beekeeping. This is LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Vann Lantz, Woodstock, Alabama. Constructive Beekeeping by Ed Clark. Section 1. Constructive Beekeeping. Commercial beekeeping has for its object the production of the maximum quantity of well-ripened honey at a minimum of cost. Swarming adds greatly to the cost of producing honey. Most methods of swarm prevention have in them the element of destructiveness. Ventilating, removing the queen, shaking the bees, removing the brood, exchanging brood bodies, loosening the cover, all destroying something that the bees have done, or adding to the work to be done in the hive. Let me state here that you are not going to be told that absolute swarm prevention is a possibility, nor will you be told that honey can be produced by absent treatment. What you will get from a good understanding of the following pages is that the beekeeper who takes advantage of the laws relating to condensation of vapor and follows where the bees have been leading will have advanced one step nearer the swarmless bee. Instead of going to the hive and telling the bees, by manipulations, don't do this, say to them, keep all your brood, keep your queen, keep the cold damp air out of the hive, and I will make your hive so perfect a condenser of water vapor that the work of evaporating water from the nectar will be done quickly. We will bring teamwork into play and each get the benefit of every advantage gained. Constructive beekeeping helps by getting the honey ripened quickly each night and stored out of the way of the queen. The hive will be maintained in such a condition that the bees will have the greatest amount of comfort in relation to the results produced. Efficiency. Familiarity with the bees makes a person wonder where the mule got his reputation for stubbornness. We must, when we work with bees, follow where they lead if we want satisfactory results. They generally know what they want and fight to do it in their own way. The bee is an economical fellow. Efficiency is his last name. For ages before our time, he has been working at the same task that he has brought to such perfection. The bees that have excited the amazement and wonder of the world as builders of geometric comb with all its economy and strength, the bees that make from the nectar of the flowers the honey, that is the superlative of all things sweet and good, have not stopped with these two achievements, but have maintained a marvel within their home which, when understood, will amaze us more than ever. The bees collect propolis, despised by the beekeeper, and with infinite work and knowledge of the laws of condensation, moisture, have varnished the inside, sealed all openings that would give upper ventilation, making out of their home a perfect condenser for the water vapor that has filled the hive air by evaporation from the nectar. This moisture they collect from the inside surface of the hive works right with their idea of economy, saving the carrying of water from the stream or spring. Cooperation. One great discovery in beekeeping was the bee space. When this space was within the limits that conformed to what instinct told them was best, peace between the beekeeper and his bees was established along this line. A similar misunderstanding is on at the present time about the best way to get rid of the moisture in the hive. The bees, from the habits and customs carried down for ages, contending that condensation is the system best adapted to their mode of life, while the beekeeper is trying to force them to use the ventilating system. I think that the beekeeper, being a most sensible person, will see the error of his way and eventually follow where the bee leads. The bees but show their contempt for ventilation when it is at its best. Urge. Swarming is the breaking into two of a populous colony of bees for the reproduction of the colony. Other swarming need not be considered here. The confusion of conceptions which arise in the mind when the term swarm prevention is mentioned has to a great extent been a hindrance to logical reasoning on this subject. At mention of the word swarm, there is conjured up from the background of our minds the exciting and spectacular scenes we have seen enacted around the apiary. What we want to prevent, not the birth, but the conception. We must go even prior to this and prevent the primal urge. To avoid confusion and give reason and logic an opportunity to work, unhampered by visions conjured up at the mention of the word swarm, the word urge will be used here to refer to the initial starting point of the swarming impulse. The urge is the direct result of actual or apparent failure of the queen. With the exception of a young queen in the hive, all other methods of urge prevention have to do with room for the queen to lay. Give the queen plenty of room to lay and swarms are reduced. Give the colony plenty of ventilation and you have fewer swarms. Young queen and shade in the afternoons reduce swarming. Room, ventilation, shade in the afternoon, and young queen have given the best results so far obtained. Conditions. What has puzzled the beekeeper is that results obtained by the same treatment year after year have not been the same, nor have the same results been obtained by similar treatments in different localities. Bees always respond to similar treatment under like conditions by giving uniform results. The beekeeper's trouble is that he makes his treatments uniform, but not his conditions. Conditions include all of the following things. 1. Temperature. 2. Direction and velocity of the wind. 3. Moisture in the air. 4. Depth of evaporation. 5. Sunshine. 6. Altitude. 7. Number of bees. 8. Fertility and vigor of the queen. 9. Number of worker cells in the hive. 10. Size of the entrance. 11. Construction of hive. 12. Fit of hive parts and cover. 13. Radiating surfaces on inside walls of the hive. 14. Number of honey and pollen producing plants. 15. The amount of water in the nectar. To show how much harder bees would have to fan at the entrance to ripen honey in some localities than in others, if they ripen it all together by ventilation, the depth of evaporation in inches, taken from a map of the Weather Bureau, is here now given. 25 inches, Ontario, Canada. 35 inches, Massachusetts. 30 inches, Ohio, northern part. 50 inches, Illinois, southern part. 50 inches, Texas, central part. 60 to 100 inches, Colorado, New Mexico, Arizona, and most of California. From this will readily be seen the different conditions under which the bees do their work in different localities due to only one of the conditions previously mentioned. It is apparent that similar treatments, as regards ventilation, cannot give uniform results in all of these places. To make the treatments as near uniform as possible and get like results under these different atmospheric conditions, we must follow the way of the bees and make the hive a condenser instead of a ventilator. Room. To look at the question of room and apply constructive treatment is our aim. If the hive room is large, good results do not always follow. So much thought has been put into the experiments carried out with different sizes of hives that the majority of beekeepers have settled on a standard size, which is best under most conditions. Some advocate one a little larger, some a little smaller, but neither deviate much from the recognized standard. So we must conclude that the bees and their keepers do not disagree greatly on the size of the hive. During the urge period, the attention of the beekeeper has mostly been given to brood rearing. To get best results, he must have the hive filled with bees at the beginning of the honey flow. He knows that swarming results when the hive is full of brood, nectar, honey, and bees, so he increases the size of the hive. As the lack of room is not the result of one condition, but of many, the added room may be more than the bees can heat. Our aim then must be to determine that nice balance between too much and too little room, ventilation, and shade. On the correct determination of this balance, our success depends. To have in our minds a conception of brood conditions in the hive prior to and at the time of the urge will give us a clearer understanding of the principal cause of the urge. By a study of the following hypothetical tabulation, the conditions of a hive can be seen. A 10-frame hive of Langstroth dimensions has, when the frames are filled with worker cells, about 66,000 of these cells. Deduct 12,000 for the ones occupied by pollen and capped honey, and there is left 54,000 cells for brood and nectar. This is about the condition of brood in a strong colony at Fargo, North Dakota, on the dates given. On July 23rd, there would be in this colony 25,000 bees under 10 days old and 44,440 bees over 10 days old. April 1st, 100 eggs. April 2nd, 100 eggs. April 3rd, 110 eggs. April 4th, 110 eggs. April 5th, 115 eggs. April 6th, 115 eggs. April 7th, 120 eggs. April 8th, 120 eggs. April 9th, 120 eggs. April 10th, 140 eggs. April 11th, 140 eggs. April 12th, 140 eggs. April 13th, 180 eggs. April 14th, 180 eggs. April 15th, 200 eggs. April 16th, 200 eggs. April 17th, 210 eggs. April 18th, 215 eggs. April 19th, 220 eggs. April 20th, 240 eggs. April 21st, 300 eggs, 3,375 brood. April 22nd, 300 eggs, 3,575 brood. April 23rd, 400 eggs, 3,875 brood. April 24th, 500 eggs, 4,265 brood. April 25th, 550 eggs, 4,705 brood. April 26th, 650 eggs, 5,240 brood. April 28th, 700 eggs, 5,825 brood. April 28th, 800 eggs, 6,505 brood. April 29th, 900 eggs, 7,285 brood. April 30th, 1,000 eggs, 8,165 brood. May 1st, 1,100 eggs, 9,125 brood. May 2nd, 1,200 eggs, 10,185 brood. May 3rd, 12,000 eggs, 11,245 brood. May 4th, 1,300 eggs, 12,365 brood. May 5th, 1,400 eggs, 13,585 brood. May 6th, 1,400 eggs, 14,785 brood. May 7th, 1,500 eggs, 16,085 brood. May 8th, 15,000 eggs, 17,375 brood. May 9th, 15,000 eggs, 18,660 brood. May 10th, 1,600 eggs, 20,040 brood. May 11th, 1,700 eggs, 21,500 brood. May 12th, 1,700 eggs, 22,900 brood. May 13th, 1,500 eggs, 24,100 brood. May 14th, 1,200 eggs, 24,900 brood. May 15th, 1,000 eggs, 25,400 brood. May 16th, 1,600 eggs, 26,450 brood. May 17th, 1,600 eggs, 27,400 brood. May 18th, 1,800 eggs, 28,500 brood. May 19th, 1,500 eggs, 29,200 brood. May 20th, 1,600 eggs, 29,900 brood. May 21st, 1,800 eggs, 30,700 brood. May 22nd, 2,200 eggs, 31,800 brood. May 23rd, 2,400 eggs, 33,000 brood. May 24th, 300 eggs, 34,800 brood. May 25th, 2,800 eggs, 36,300 brood. May 26th, 2,400 eggs, 37,300 brood. May 27th, 2,600 eggs, 38,500 brood. May 28th, 3,000 eggs, 40,000 brood. May 29th, 2,500 eggs, 41,000 brood. May 30th, 2,400 eggs, 41,900 brood. May 31st, 2,000 eggs, 42,300 brood. June 1st, 2,400 eggs, 34,000 brood. June 2nd, 3,000 eggs, 44,300 brood. June 3rd, 3,400 eggs, 46,200 brood. June 4th, 3,000 eggs, 48,000 brood. June 5th, 3,200 eggs, 50,200 brood. June 6th, 3,100 eggs, 51,700 brood. June 7th, 3,000 eggs, 53,100 brood. June 8th, 2,400 eggs, 53,700 brood. June 9th, 3,000 eggs, 55,200 brood. June 10th, 3,200 eggs, 56,800 brood. June 11th, 3,000 eggs, 58,000 brood. June 12th, 2,500 eggs, 58,300 brood. June 13th, 2,400 eggs, 58,300 brood. June 14th, 3,000 eggs, 58,300 brood. June 15th, 2,800 eggs, 58,300 brood. June 16th, 2,400 eggs, 58,300 brood. June 17th, 2,600 eggs, 58,300 brood. June 18th, 3,000 eggs, 58,300 brood. June 19th, 2,500 eggs, 58,300 brood. June 20th, 2,400 eggs, 58,300 brood. June 21st, 2,000 eggs, 58,300 brood. June 22nd, 2,400 eggs, 58,300 brood. June 23rd, 3,000 eggs, 58,300 brood. It can be readily seen that when the hive is filled with brood honey and pollen, when sunshine and flowers are tempting the bees to work almost to madness, the honey coming in deposited in cells and interfering with the laying of the queen, their system of housekeeping is disorganized. Their instinct tells them now is the time to get things in shape for swarming. Another condition of hive that gives like results is when the cells are filled with nectar and the conditions of atmosphere and hive such that little or no evaporation takes place. End of section 1.